In this video, I'm going to be taking a look at the FLSUN Super Racer, a printer capable, allegedly, of printing at speeds of over 150 millimeters per second out of the box. Can it? Let's take a look. A lot of you might know that my first 3D printer was actually a Delta. It's still here, mostly because I have no idea what else to do with it. The Mini Delta was a good printer and capable of some genuinely usable prints. But the mug-sized build plate and the lackluster bed leveling, it was a huge relief to eventually move on to Cartesian-style printers like the Ender 3. But this is different. This is big. At no less than 1.04 meters from base to the top of the filament reel, this is an absolute monster of printer, yet it somehow still fits on pretty much any desk, because while it's tall, it's no larger than a standard Ender clone. If you want tall but you haven't got space for wide or deep, this is a good choice. Since receiving this unit, FLSUN have contacted me directly to ask me to mention that they have announced a new model, I know, coming out soon, which I have no problem with mentioning, and I will point you to a link in the description. FLSUN have also suggested checking their Facebook group to see announcements, and I have to say that while there's nearly no information about this printer right now, 400 millimeters per second sounds interesting, to say the least. If you would like to know more, then go look at the description or go check on their Facebook page. So, back to this printer. It has a volcano-style hot end with a V6-style cold end. Although notably, if we look at the spare hot end they provide, which is an interesting thing to do, to be honest. I don't think I've ever been given an entire hot end with a printer before, but it does help me to show you it. The heat throat, that's this bit here, this is wider than in your standard V6. There is a version of the V6 that has this, but anyway, this is a good giveaway when you see a wide heat throat like this. It usually, but not always, will indicate that your hot end is PTFE lined all the way down to the nozzle. Good points with that are the suitability for PLA and resistance to that melting and sticking to the inside of the pipes, which can be a real pain. The bad points, though, are its limitation on maximum temperature. I generally stick to below 230 degrees C on PTFE-lined hot ends. You can go a bit further, especially if you put Capricorn in there like I have here. We'll get to that in a moment. One thing I like about this Delta is the filament path. A lot of printers have a kind of meh attitude towards the path the filament takes before it gets to the actual extruder, and this can cause all sorts of wear or problems. But here you can see a bit of where the extra cost of the printer has been spent. You have a PTFE pipe running through the chassis straight into the filament runout sensor, and then it's a direct line down to the extruder. This is really good from a friction and wear point of view. The Bowden extruder is a standard BMG-esque style thing, and I'll lay my cards on the table, I do not like these. In this printer, during testing, it has been working mostly fine, but I've spoken to a couple of people who have had problems with it. For me, it's just a bit noisy and will probably at some point need replacing. That's no issue for someone like me who knows how to do it, including the calibration bit you have to do afterwards with the E-steps. It's probably a 20-minute job to swap out the extruder, then another half hour to calibrate it. This doesn't bother me. Why do I hate these extruders so much? Well, the number one reason is that this washer and spring on the lever has to be unscrewed to open it, and it's not a captive washer, so 6 times out of 10 I would say you spend the next half hour hunting around on the floor for the washer and the spring. Also, it has a 3-to-1 ratio on the movement of the stepper motor to the movement of the filament. You'd think that this would add extra torque, but to be honest, it just adds extra noise. I think it's probably worth pointing out that whatever extruder they put on this printer, we would probably hate it anyway. Cheaper extruders tend to be just deeply unpopular. It's almost like you have to spend at least £40 to get something that you have no reason to complain about. So really, it's a bit of a whatever. The effector, because that's what you call this thing, it seems pretty well designed to me. It's one of the few printers that I've seen that actually comes with dual 4010 fans as stock. This means part cooling is coming from both sides, which is definitely a good thing as it cools better and it should, in theory, produce better overhangs. In my tests, print quality was broadly good. Delta geometry doesn't always lend itself to accuracy, but I found that the calibration pieces are about the same size they should be, and there's no kind of bulging corners or anything, you know, no rounding. And when printing at more sensible speeds, artifacts are definitely well controlled. Stringing is basically non-existent for PLA under the default profiles, and the good cooling means a decent overhang performance too. If you crank it up to the top speed of 200 millimeters per second, then of course you're going to start seeing some of these results degrade quite a bit. The downside to deltas in general, and this is somewhat taken to the extreme because of the height of this specific printer, is the huge length of the Bowden tube. That is, the tube that runs from the extruder where the filament is pushed from to the effector at the other end where the filament is melted and made into a thing. The issue you run into is especially when you use flexible filament like TPU, and this makes delta printers really not that suitable for this kind of printing. I did some tests and I found it quite frustrating, and if you watch the channel regularly, you'll know that I'm not exactly new to TPU either. I kind of know how to print it. I would suggest that if you do want to print flexible filament, then use the stiffest you can find. I personally recommend Nuli or Zero TPU, this is just from my experience. On my test piece, Sunlu filament would not play nice at all and it just kept failing, it kept repeatedly curling up in the extruder, but Zero worked fine when I tweaked the settings and the speed right down. I changed the Bowden tube also for a Capricorn tube to test if that would help. The main advantage to using Capricorn tubing, in my opinion, is the smaller internal diameter to the tube. Whether it made a difference is hard to say. I think it might have slightly because I did manage to print the octopus here first time. Although I have previously explained why this is an easy model to print anyway. Nonetheless, I will share the TPU profiles I made that I had success with, see the description. So, about the bed. Bed leveling is done by means of this thing that you clip on, and it's held on magnetically, pretty securely as well. It's basically a tactile micro switch. I'm a huge fan of this as it's super accurate, it uses minimal parts, and once your mesh is stored on the firmware, you don't have to carry that weight around with you on the effector. Because the bed is mounted basically solidly, you don't really have any need to re-level often, if at all. If you hate leveling or adjusting the bed and having to constantly deal with that, then this is absolutely something you should pay attention to. This might be a good choice for you. The bed is round, as you may have noticed, which means the build area is sort of the same as an Ender 3, but also sort of different. It's missing the corners. The build volume is 26 centimeters in diameter, with a huge 33 centimeters height, which is just over a foot. I don't personally tend to use the bundled software that I get with printers, as it's normally an old version or whatever, and I just run one version of Cura on my computer for many printers. I would advise other people to do this, just get normal Cura, and in this case a profile already exists, so you can be up and running faster than you probably could if you tried to use the software on the SD card anyway. Which, by the way, the SD card comes with this reader, which is cool. I've not tried the printer with Prusa Slicer yet, but the included Cura profiles default to the aforementioned 150mm per second, which is quite crazy, to put it lightly. And if you see my last video on energy usage, you will have already noticed that the standard benchy takes only 47 minutes, which at 150mm per second is still quite long. It can be brought right down. I did a test one at 17 minutes and it came out okay. There's a lot more that you could tune here, and given a day or two to play with it, I reckon I could probably get one done in 10 minutes, no problem. I'm actually a huge fan of the interface. The default screen shows you exactly what you need, but it also shows you the current print speed. I've not seen anything like this on any other printers. What I really like though about this screen is it's actually capacitive in terms of the touch mechanism. As a result, it sort of works really responsively. It's the same as the one on your phone. It does beep when you press it, and I don't believe you can turn that off, but it's not something that concerns me. I like the audible feedback, and it's not like you're pressing it all the time. What the screen does lack though, which would be nice, is any ability to tune the printer beyond the very basics. If I wanted to change the extruder, for example, I would then need to recalibrate the E-steps, which is the ratio of the motor to the filament movement, and normally Marlin would let you do that on the on-screen interface, but instead you would have to connect Octoprint or a USB cable to the printer and use some communication software to do that. Not a massive hassle, but an extra step that you would have to take because it's not supported on the screen. In terms of the build process, I'm not really going to cover it at all. I didn't even record the footage. The printer is around a half hour build, and the only thing you really have to take away from it is how easy it is to just put the screws in at the top and the bottom. You probably need to be quite strong. You have to flip the thing over. The effector itself just snaps on with the arms being spring loaded. I'd say it's about half an hour for total build time. I am, however, going to poke around inside. I've heard that these printers have in the past come with two different boards on them, one being an SKR, I think 1.3, and then the other one being the MKS Robin Nano. I don't think FLSUN have released their Marlin source code, I couldn't find it. Another thing that's good to see is a decent supply of spare parts available, especially with respect to the build plate and the touchscreen. The leveling sensor as well is available and it is not too pricey, so if you lose that, you don't need to massively worry about it. So I guess I need to wrap this up into some kind of conclusion. Firstly, this is one of the most robust and well-built printers that I've seen in the price range. The build quality is way higher than you would expect, and with the slidey rails and carbon fiber rods, as well as the hugely thick profiles on the corners, it's just not messing about. I think the real positives are the ease of use and setup time, the speed and performance, the build quality and the frame sturdiness, the bed and its leveling system, and the fact that it's given me almost no problems over the review process. I actually would think that this could be a printer that you might recommend to someone who is a beginner because it just kind of prints without giving you any trouble. I think the negatives would be the challenges to print flexible filaments, the relatively weak extruder design. Overall though, I am surprised what you get here for your money. Delta printers are never particularly cheap compared to Cartesian ones, and the fact that they've managed to present such a polished product here is quite impressive. Granted, it's not perfect, but the changes that you have to make it perfect in the future, I think even just as simple as just a new extruder and some Capricorn tubing would make this into an absolute beast. Anyway, that is it for now. As I mentioned at the start, there's a video on the way about Delta printers in general, which I'm both looking forward to and dreading. You should see the maths, so watch out for that. All links are below in the description, and please check out our Discord. Let me know what you think about this printer, let me know what you think about Delta printers, let me know if you have one. Put it in the comments, and I will see you next time.